We can classify computational problems into those that can be solved and those that cannot be solved. And there are many more problems that cannot be solved than there are problems that can be solved. But of course, the problems that can be solved are of particular interest. And what we would like to do is, we would like to understand further, for the problems that can be solved, what kind of resources we need to solve them. So the ultimate goal is to group all of the problems we have into complexity classes. A complexity class is simply a set of computational problems which can be computed within a given resource or in a particular setting. Ultimately, our goal really is to classify all computational problems. We want to group them into these complexity classes so that when we have a problem, we know exactly what type of resources and how much of a particular resource we need to solve that problem. The first computational resource we want to look at more closely is the resource time. So how much time do we need to solve a particular problem? Specifically, we want to know which problems can be solved quickly and which problems cannot be solved quickly. And when I say quickly, I mean efficiently, which means in polynomial time in the size of the input. So this gives rise to a complexity class, which is called P, or P time, which stands for polynomial time. And it contains all the decision problems that are decidable in polynomial time in the size of the input. That is, all the problems for which there is a polynomial function T, such that there exists a Turing machine that decides that problem in time, at most, T of n. Of course, we want our complexity classes to be meaningful, and we want the complexity class P to be meaningful as well. And for the class to be meaningful, it has to be somewhat robust. I mean, here we are talking about Turing machine as the formal model of what computation is. But of course, we could think about other types of computers. We could think about the laptop we have, or a smartphone we have, or things like that. I mean, arguably, all of these are computers that look quite different than a Turing machine and can possibly do other things than Turing machines. So we have to think about the model of a Turing machine and that it really captures all the other devices we have. And we already talked about this type of robustness property. We said, well, if something can be computed by some physical computational device, then it can also be computed by a Turing machine. And we called this the Church-Turing thesis, which cannot be proven, but so far seems to be true. What we now need is a stronger statement. We need something along the lines of, if there exists a computational device, like a normal laptop or something like that, that can solve a problem quickly, then a Turing machine can solve that problem quickly as well. So not only should a Turing machine be able to simulate any other computational device we might have, it should be able to do so efficiently. So there should be no great slowdown in the simulation. If your laptop can solve something efficiently, then a Turing machine should be able to solve it efficiently as well. This idea is captured in what's called the strong Church-Turing thesis. It states that every physically reliable computation device, let it be silicon-based, DNA-based, neuron-based, can be simulated by a Turing machine with only a polynomial overhead. You will notice that the only difference between the Church-Turing thesis and the strong Church-Turing thesis is the addition of the phrase with polynomial overhead. So not only should the simulation be possible, the simulation should also be efficient. The Church Turing thesis is believed by virtually everybody I know. The strong Church Turing thesis is a bit more debatable. Again, it's an informal statement, so it's not something we would be able to prove. But it would be possible to disprove the strong Church Turing thesis. All you would need to do is build some kind of computation device that would be able to solve some problem much faster than a Turing machine can. And this might be possible with the invention of quantum computing in particular. So right now it's unclear whether the strong Church Turing thesis is true or not. It's too early to tell. But even if the strong Church Turing thesis is not true because of quantum computation, it probably is true for all classical computation. So everything apart from quantum computation is probably roughly the same as a Turing machine in terms of time complexity. So even if the strong Church Turing thesis turns out to be wrong, it will still apply to all the classical computation, and therefore everything we will learn about computation using the complexity class P and so on will still be meaningful in that setting. Keeping all this in mind, from now on we will just assume that the strong Church Turing thesis is indeed true. Certainly all the different variants of Turing machines we have discussed, like Turing machines with multiple tapes, for example, can be simulated by a standard Turing machine. Not only in principle, but the simulation can even be done efficiently. And the simulations I told you about were, in fact, efficient simulations. Some of them had a linear slowdown, some had a quadratic slowdown, but all of them had at most a polynomial slowdown.